Good morning, colleagues, and welcome to the seventh meeting in 2016 of the Finance Committee. Although I think it's fair to point out that our remit has now been extended to include the Constitution, so we're now the Finance and Constitution Committee. I'm sure we're all delighted by that. Agenda item one. The first item on our agenda is to decide whether to take item three in private. Are members agreed? Thank you. The second item on our agenda today is to continue to take evidence as part of our inquiry into the first year operation of the Land and Buildings Transaction Tax. We have two separate sessions on LBTT today. And the first one is considering the Scottish Fiscal Commission's 2015-16 Outrun Turn report, and we're joined on this by all three members of the Commission who exist at the moment. And I welcome to the meeting Lady Susan Rice, who's the chair of the Scottish Fiscal Commission, Professor Campbell Leaf, and Professor Charles Nolan. Now, I know members will receive copies of the correspondence from the clerks. Lady Rice, I wonder if you want to make an opening statement?
I'll just say a few words, and first of all, thank you very much to the committee for having us. We met you, and most of you met us at your business planning day, but we thought it was important that all three of us were here. And although the previous committee has seen Campbell and myself regularly, this is Charles's first appearance before the committee, so you're really in the hot seat, Charles. And just a couple of words. Charles is our interim appointee, approved by yourselves up until April 1st next year. He came on board at the beginning of the summer and has just jumped in, with 2 feet, and has added huge value right from the beginning. So this transition has been really quite seamless for us. Charles, professor of economics at Glasgow University, but an early part of his career worked in forecasting at the Bank of England, so he brings a different perspective to our conversations. That's very good. Campbell, also professor of economics at Glasgow. And in terms of the outturn report, although there were lots of inputs to it, this was absolutely sort of led and shaped by Campbell at the late spring and early summer. So my thanks to both individuals. A tiny bit of context then. A reminder to the committee, I know you know this, but I remind people all the time who have any interest that we are in the third year, the Commission is in the third year of acting in a capacity as a body that scrutinizes forecasts which are produced by the government. So we scrutinize. That is our only remit now, and we report on our findings. We are not doing the forecasting now. We are getting ready to begin that as of next April, but just a reminder. The second thing is that if one looks at previous recent evidence sessions, there has been some chat about all the different reports that seem to reflect housing or property transactions and tax, and so the LBTT intake. So just a quick reminder in layman's terms that we have for any property transaction, the date of the transaction itself, which then leads to the requirement that some tax be paid. The tax is then paid, but that's always subsequent or generally subsequent to the date of the transaction. And if the property transaction is towards the end of the month, the tax might well be recorded by Revenue Scotland in the following month. So if you look at month figures, you've got a bit of disparity. Then Registers of Scotland register the transaction, but they wait until the tax return has been filed and the tax is in. So there is a sequence that happens. Registers of Scotland will include all properties, including those all transactions under £145,000, which don't attract the requirement for LBTT. So those of us who are looking just at tax obviously don't need to look at those transactions. And finally, the Property Federation, we believe, which also publishes statistics, we believe that they work on a calendar year rather than the fiscal year. So you've got different time frames as well. And it's just, we remind ourselves about these differences. It's just probably important to restate them here. We believe that if you go to the raw data behind Revenue Scotland, behind our Registers of Scotland, we can actually reconcile those numbers with ours. So we're not troubled by what appear in the published reports to be disparities. We would say that if you are interested in forestalling as a phenomenon, you should probably not use the Registers of Scotland data because of the way it smooths the activity. It won't give you as clear a picture, and they're not collecting data to reflect forestalling. And I think that's really, really all to say. The outturn report, which I think you want to consider, is based on, as it states, based on Revenue Scotland outturn numbers. So that is the relationship that we've used. And we look forward to your questions.
Thank you, Lady Susan. That's actually, I've been asking questions around these issues and comparability from different sets of figures in previous meetings. So that actual explanation of how that different sequence from different organisations produces the apparent disparate information is actually very helpful to me. I'm sure it is to the rest of the committee. I'm interested in the forecasting model. I'm assuming from what you've said, Lady Rees, it's a government forecasting model in the meantime, but how it works in operation is interesting me because it involves mean and median house prices as well as volumes of transaction forecasts. Now we can see all these things can be brought together, but it's how they are applied thereafter that I'm struggling to understand, and it would be helpful if someone could explain to me how that methodology or that modelling actually works.
So there's essentially three economic determinants go into the residential LBTT forecast, as you say: the average house price, the median house price, and the volume of transactions. So these are forecast separately by Scottish Government analysts. These are then converted into revenue forecasts based on the application of a kind of probability distribution. So this works as follows. You can imagine all the transactions taking place in the economy. Some will be for relatively inexpensive houses, others will be for expensive houses. And what you find is if you plot all these transactions for a given period of time, you can fit a curve to all these transactions, which explains the patterns you see in the data. And the curve that fits it is what's called a log normal distribution. So it basically says that if you were to randomly pick a transaction from the Registers of Scotland's database, it would give you the probability that that transaction would have a particular price. And there's a far higher probability that it's going to be relatively cheap, and a very small probability that it's going to be a very expensive house. But that distribution of price transactions seems to fit the data. So what the Scottish Government does is it forecasts average house prices and median house prices, and it uses those to shift this distribution forward. Okay, so as average prices go up, you're going to have more transactions at the upper end of the market and less at the lower end. So what the government does is it forecasts the average and the median, and that relocates this probability distribution. It then forecasts the total volume of transactions and then multiplies that by the probability that each transaction is going to be at a certain price point. It then applies the tax rate that you would apply to a house of that size, that value, and calculates the tax revenue as a result.
Okay. It's complicated. But I guess the secondary question to that then is, with that model being applied, and obviously the forecasts weren't quite where the outturn turned out, where do you think in the forecasting process that disparity, if that's the right word, actually arose?
If you look at Table 1 in our outturn report, this is exactly what we try to do. I'll let everyone get to it. Okay. So what we do in Table 1 is that the first column of Table 1 gives details of what was forecast for the relevant economic determinant. The second column gives what the outturn was. So average house prices were forecast to be 174,000. The average house price turned out to only be 166,000. The third column then runs that revised piece of data through this probabilistic model that's been developed for forecasting and computes a revised forecast. So by combining all these different ways in which the forecast economic determinants were not quite the same as the outturns, we can compute a revised forecast, and by the combined effect of those would be that you would expect revenues of 196 million, not the 235 million that was originally forecast, which if you add in the ADS for stalling of between 5 and 7 million, means that the probabilistic model in aggregate fits relatively well once you forecast average, median, and house prices and transactions correctly.
Okay. Ivan.
Yeah. All right, thanks for that. Just for a start, just draw members' attention to my register of interests with respect to property investments. Yeah, I mean, there's obviously quite a lot in this, so I'll try not to chew up too much of the time. What you've basically done is compared the outturn to the forecast, which is fine as far as it goes, but the problem with that, of course, is that all that might mean is that the forecast was wrong. I know the forecast was changed through the year. So if the forecast is wrong, then that's all it tells you. What I'm kind of more interested in is the outcome compared to previous years, if that makes sense. And if the total tax take has gone down compared to previous years as a consequence of the change to LBTT. So it might be interesting to comment on that, and we can drill into that in a bit more detail. But just coming back to the forecasting very briefly, I understand what you're saying about the modelling of that, but again, clearly there's no historical data to base that on because we've got a change. My statistics is a bit rusty, but I think the log normal depends on what value you have for the standard deviation, and if that's changed, then you're going to have a different profile. And I think all the data is telling you is that that's what's happened. The forecast aspect of the log normal hasn't fitted to what's happened because they haven't forecast it correctly and picked the right values there. And if you look at the average and the median, then both of those are taking a downward shift. And you're right, there's a tilt away from the upper end of the house spectrum, because the difference between those two is bigger than it was before. But with them both being down, that says there's clearly an impact there in terms of the forecast is wrong because the expected house prices in general, not just the distribution, to be higher than it was. So that's kind of just maybe comment on that round about the forecasting. But as I say, the biggest thing I really want to talk about is how it impacts against previous years. In the data I've seen, the number of transactions in the key 325 to 750 range look to be at least as high as they were previously. The number of transactions in the top range, I don't think there's any issue there apart from forestalling. They've held up very well as far as I can see. So maybe just want to comment on that.
Well, a lot there.
Sure.
I'll try and remember each of them. Okay, so table one is essentially, it's not just comparing the forecast with the outturn, it's trying to decompose the forecast error by rerunning the forecasting methodology with actual outturn data piece by piece. So what that suggests is that the biggest element of the forecast, or the biggest impact in the forecast, was through failing to forecast average house prices. Okay, and the fact that average house prices didn't rise relative to median house prices is indicative of a shift in the transactions away from the top end of the market towards the middle and bottom end. And that's largely the reason for the fall in revenues, which relative to expectations, which is what we then try to analyze throughout the next section of the report. So in terms of the standard deviation of the log normal, essentially once you know the mean and the median, those tell you the standard deviation. You can calculate the standard deviation from that. So that this, the fact that average house prices have not risen relative to median house prices is telling you that the standard deviation has shifted and the shape of the distribution has moved towards the lower end of the market. In terms of comparing with historical data, that was kind of difficult because this is a completely different tax regime. I think when the tax regime was first implemented, it was designed to be revenue neutral, but then when the rest of the UK adjusted their tax regime, that lowered the tax take that you would have expected from that, and tax bands and rates were adjusted for Scotland as well, so you wouldn't expect revenues from this tax regime to be comparable historically. In terms of historical transactions, we've been looking at decomposing the forecast itself. I think in the evidence that the Scottish Government provided to the committee in a meeting a week or so ago, they did look at transactions historically using Registers of Scotland data, and I think it's table one of that document, if I remember correctly, and I think what they find is that over a two-year period, there's substantial growth in many of the price bands, except for the 325 to 750 band, where it only grows by 1%. One of the things we referred to in our report last year was that there's a large kind of fiscal drag effect in the Scottish Government's forecasts. And this arises because as house prices rise, you pull more properties into this 325, 750 price band. So you would be expecting transactions in that zone to be increasing over time, not growing at just 1%.
Yeah, I mean, if you look back at the data I've got, and I've not compared this to your log norm, I've not had time to do that, but basically it's saying that the percentage in the 325 to 750 range, percentage of transactions, of the total transactions, is about 7.5%, and it's been between 7 and 8% right through the last couple of years, apart from the quarter, obviously, where the first stalling kicked in, where it was over 10% prior to the change. So that kind of suggests that the amount of transactions in that range hasn't changed as a percentage of the total. But I think what you're saying is you would have expected it to increase because of the drag in the market.
And I think if you looked at the average numbers pre and post financial crisis, they were a bit higher and lower before, so the share did seem to, if you looked at those two relative averages, the share would be marginally lower, I would expect, but you would expect it to rise over time for the reasons I've just given.
Okay, and I suppose a very, very final point then is that if the question is asked, has the increase or the change to LBTT hurt the tax take to the Scottish Government, which I think is the key question, you're saying you can't answer that question because it's a different thing, it's apples and oranges.
It's a different tax regime, so you weren't expecting it to generate the same amount of tax.
Okay, Murdo.
Thank you, Convener. I might just pursue some of these questions that Ivan McKee was raising. Just looking at Table 3 in your paper, which is the outturn revenues against forecasts, it's clear that the most sensitive price bracket is the 325 to 750 bracket, as you mentioned, where, you know, compared to the other brackets, there's been a substantial reduction in the outturn revenue compared to forecast. I've bored members of this committee in the past with my personal anecdotes about the property market in the country areas. We've heard quite a lot of evidence actually from people who've spoken to the committee about, you know, the slowdown in the property market in larger properties, particularly in the country areas. Do you accept that there's an issue with the breadth of that band in the 325 to 750? So if the number of transactions in that bracket is holding up, that might be because we're seeing more transactions grouped at the lower end in the 300,000s and fewer over 500,000, which would show that the level of transactions was the same, but in fact the average price has therefore fallen, and therefore the tax take has fallen as well. Would that be fair?
Yes, it's possible. I mean, we only have Revenue Scotland data for the entire band. We don't have sub-bands within the band. It would be useful to have that information to do that kind of analysis.
Yeah, I think that's something the committee has picked up in a previous session, that trying to interrogate the data further to understand what's happening within such a broad band would be very useful. On the question of forestalling, you make a comment in paragraph 3.14 about the forestalling impact in March 2016, where because of the impact of the additional dwelling supplement, there was a jump in the tax revenues in March 2016. So is it fair to say that without that forestalling impact, the outturn actually would have been worse?
Yes, transactions were brought forward and appear to have been brought forward into March. It was a particularly buoyant month. It's not obviously as buoyant in the following month, so it looks as though there's an element of forestalling there. If you took that away, revenues would be lower.
Yeah. So you might expect, as we work through, without that forestalling being a feature, presumably, in this financial year or the subsequent, that will disappear. So we'll see a more normal pattern appearing.
Yeah, so in the report, we only look at March, and then we look at April to see whether those buoyant returns in March were sustained into April. Our tentative conclusion at the moment is that they weren't, but we will continue to monitor outturn data for this year as it emerges.
Okay. My final question, Convener, I think this really goes to the heart of the matter, and it's really covered by your comments in paragraph 3.24 about what's been happening in the market, particularly the 325 to 750 band. I mean, is it your view that the rate at which LBTT has been set, affecting properties in that band, that is what's had an impact on reducing activity and therefore reducing the tax take?
Yeah, I think we cannot draw that definitive conclusion based on the limited data we have at the moment. So I think what the report does at the moment is notes that's the band in which revenues seem to be lower. There could be various reasons for that. One of them could be a behavioural response here. It could be other shifts in the market. It could be the log normal distribution is maybe not fitting the top end of the distribution as well as we would like it to. There's various explanations. So we cannot rule out that possibility. We cannot definitively conclude that that's the case at present. We continue to monitor the data as it emerges.
And at what point do we get to where we would have sufficient data to be able to draw these conclusions?
We need to be sure, for example, we need to rule out all other options. That's this. So we need to rule out the possibility that it wasn't damage to the property market in the Aberdeen area that was causing this. We would need to look at whether the log normal distribution was fitting the top end properly. We continue to explore that issue, and effectively by ruling out all other options, you would conclude that we cannot reject that hypothesis.
Right. And you'd quite a long time, couldn't it?
Because, yeah.
I mean, you think about even additional dwelling supplement, it'll be 18 months down the line before we have final data on that, because there's a long period of reclaim, and that's, you know, that's going to affect how we, you know, what we can take from the data. We have only 1 year's data at the moment. After ADS is all sorted, we'll have 2.5 years' data. We'll be in a better position, but we probably can't definitively claim now that would be enough, but we'll certainly be in a better position, I would think.
But it is something you're keeping.
Yeah, most of the tax take comes from the top two bands. So yeah. Clearly, if you're forecasting the tax take, you want to get those two, you want to get those two right.
Thank you.
Murdo and yourselves has had a discussion about the breakdown of the figures between 325 and 750. It's something we've discussed with other witnesses who've come to give us evidence. Have you had any discussions with Revenue Scotland over that issue about how that might be? We get that breakdown information between 325 and 750 made more readily available?
I think we requested data broken down as much as possible, and the data that was received was broken down by price band. I don't know if further breakdown would be available. Earlier this week, we've also asked the team in Governor's House to ask for a next round of data broken down as much as possible, not only by month and price band, but ideally by region as well. So we want to look at the kind of regional distribution of this as well to start exploring whether there's other explanations.
Yeah, well, we've got the revenue folk coming to us after this evidence taken session, and some we can follow up with them. Willie?
This is the time where you are so thankful that you studied maths and statistics for 3 years at university a number of years ago, and ultimately it comes in handy. I'm so thankful for that, and I think I followed most of the previous discussion there on the log normal distribution and so on and so forth. But the question I had for you was, there was some discussion at the previous committee about the impact on the higher tax take range from 750k and above, and there was some discussion and indeed contributions from colleagues who gave evidence last week that additional measures needed to be introduced to help that side of the market, but that doesn't appear to be borne out by the data that you've presented here in table 3. Professor Leith, you referred to it earlier. You can see that in the bracket over 750k, in fact that was the best performing bracket in terms of tax return of all of them. And of course, I don't think that data was available to us in previous weeks, but I think that's quite clear. So would you confirm that I'm reading your table correctly, and that the higher bracket, the higher value property bracket, was in fact the best performing against forecast?
Yes. So if you look at I think there's a graph which maybe shows it more clearly. If you look at figure 2, It's just above paragraph 320.
Oh, yeah.
Yep. So if you look at the bottom right-hand corner, that gives you the black solid line is the tax take by month throughout the year. And you and the high dotted line, or no, the darker dotted line. Yeah, I've got it in black and white.
For those of you watching in black and white,
as an academic, I only do black and white.
It would help if you just give you the colour one now. That's
it. Actually, I've got a colour one here.
My colleagues are more sophisticated than me. Just above 320. Brilliant.
Okay.
Yeah. So the solid red line is OLED. The solid red line is the tax take by month throughout the year, and you can see relative to the blue line, which is the revenue we expected by month throughout the year, there's a significant amount of forestalling in the first part of the year. But then the revenues recover quite sharply, and the tax take is above prediction for that tax band, and then you get the big jump in March, potentially because of the forestalling effects of EDS. So it does appear to be a forestalling effect at the early part of the month, but it's more than compensated for by the performance for that price band throughout the rest of the year.
Yeah. Convener, it reminds me of the snooker incident where, for those of you watching in black and white, the blue ball is behind the red one. The follow-up question to that was, I think you mentioned earlier, Professor Leith, that there was a kind of shift to the lower end in the distribution curve, but what's happened is that the best performing group is still the highest value property range. So what would explain that? If there's a shift towards the slightly cheaper end of the market, but what would cause the best performers to be then the higher range?
Yeah, so it's more as a kind of twist in the distribution. So it's the top end is kind of holding steady, but then that 325 to 750, somewhere within that distribution, things are tilting. Exactly why, we cannot know for sure. There's a variety of reasons why. The top end may just not be sensitive to paying that tax. Who knows?
Okay. Well, time for a second question, please. On table 8... colleagues, there aren't any page numbers here. It's table 8. It's about the difference in forecast between Scottish Government and OBR. It's quite difficult to actually interpret that just from the numerical table there, but if you were to plot that, you would see that in terms of the OBR forecast, there was a significant reduction in their forecast in November 15 compared to Scottish Government forecast, which remained pretty steady. And the outturn result of all of that was that the outturn result was pretty close to what Scottish Government forecasts actually were compared to the OBR. Could you offer any explanation as to why that would be and why there'd be such a downturn in volatility with the OBR forecast?
Well, I think the OBR November 2015 was looking at the outturn data for the year to date. And that was being hit by the forestalling effect. So it was down. They were extrapolating. We need to ask them, but I think they were extrapolating that for the rest of the year and using that to infer a revised forecast.
Looking at the same data, why would they come to such radically different forecasts?
The Scottish Government data? Didn't use the in-year data to do any forecast revisions.
But the more accurate and more stable, let me say, the more stable forecasts seem to have come from the Scottish Government.
The Scottish Government's forecast is the revised one is essentially... So for the 16-17 budget, as a byproduct of producing the forecast for that, they come up with another forecast for 15-16, which is essentially just extrapolating the methodology they already used for 15-16. So it's bound to be pretty close.
Okay, thanks. I thought we'd ask that. Thanks very much.
Okay, Adam Tompkins.
Thank you, Convener. I wanted to ask a different sort of set of questions about your reflections on the experience of devolved taxation so far, in terms particularly of the kind of key institutional relationships and how you see them working, where you think the strengths are and where you think the weaknesses are. And I suppose I'm thinking in particular of the relationship between Revenue Scotland and the Scottish Ministers. Is that the right model? And the relationship between Revenue Scotland and HMRC, but don't feel that you have to confine your answers to those relationships if you think others are even more important. But obviously one of the reasons why the committee is looking at LBTT is partly because we want to understand how LBTT is working, but partly because we've got an eye on the future as well as on the past in terms of thinking about the onward progression of fiscal devolution through the lifetime of the first half of this parliament in particular. So are there any kind of key lessons that you think we should learn in terms of institutional design and institutional relationships?
I won't be able, without thinking for a minute or two, to respond to the key lessons. But what I would say is that you raise a really important point, because the relationships amongst all of these different agencies matter. And it matters that they are formalized and that the interactions are done in a disciplined way. And that's done typically through memoranda of understanding. It's important that there is good cooperation where needed. So it's easier for me to respond a little bit by anecdote, because our own role will be changing, and therefore our relationship to the agencies that you mentioned will change quite deeply come April 1st. And so we're very thoughtful about this issue. Up until this point, including this year, the OBR, when it's been doing its forecasting in the areas that involve devolved taxes here, have invited the commissioners to join in their challenge meetings, which is, you know, the meetings en route to coming up with their forecast. And there has been a good working, informal, if you will, but working relationship between the OBR and the SFC that's developed over the last 2.5 years since we've existed. And we anticipate that relationship to continue to be mutually supportive when it's appropriate, and indeed the legislation requires that we work together, and we think that means working together properly. The OBR would typically, for income tax, get data from HMRC. HMRC, like Revenue Scotland, has an obligation legally, I believe, to protect identity, and so what is delivered, for instance, to the OBR may be analyzed by HMRC staff, and then the answer to a particular question is given outside of the HMRC in a way that doesn't reveal individual identities. And so those kinds of disciplines Revenue Scotland has to, and it's our understanding that they do, I mean, we don't critique Revenue Scotland, but that they would behave in that way. As questions come up, and for us in Scotland, as the devolved taxes also increase in number, each one is a little different from the other, we have to work out how these relationships will need to work. And we do that through engagement and then the development of a memorandum of understanding for each agency. So you're asking if these things work well. I think it's very hard for us to make that judgment, to be very honest. But I really do want to emphasize how important a question it is and how important it is that we work to make those relationships work well.
There are no particular points of kind of concern or anxiety that you have about the institutional framework of devolved taxation that you'd like to bring to our attention?
I would not, to be very honest. I mean, maybe my colleagues would speak up, but the question is so broad. I would be troubled to say I have a thought-through, evidence-based response to that question at this stage. We will perhaps think more about that. Charles, do you have anything to?
No, as you say, it's quite a broad question. I need to really think about it to say something sensible, I think.
Yeah.
I think I would just maybe make one point. So at the moment, we're going through the transition from being a body which scrutinises the Scottish Government's forecasts to being a body which produces our own forecasts. Now, if you look at the way the OBR does this, that they have relationships with various other bodies, that they provide certain key macroeconomic determinants to HMRC, who will then deliver a forecast of the tax revenues those economic determinants imply. We're in the process of developing a kind of operating model which explores whether we'll do it this way or maybe some other way with Scottish Government, with HMRC, with Department of Work and Pensions, with Revenue Scotland, all these various bodies. And I think the key principles underpinning that is that we need to ensure the Fiscal Commission has independence, that it owns the forecasts that it produces, and to the extent that is logistically and resource feasible, owns the models, owns the data analysis, has the resources to do that without relying too much on Scottish Government analysts.
Thank you very much.
I'm not seeing anybody else indicating they've got any other questions at this stage, so thank you very much to those witnesses coming along and giving us evidence this morning. We're very grateful for you giving us your time, and we'll speak to you over the coming years. Again, so at the moment I suspend this particular part of the meeting to allow changeover of witnesses. If somebody also wants to get a refreshment, please feel free to do so. Okay, colleagues, we'll now continue to take consideration of the first year's operation of LBTT by taking evidence from Revenue Scotland, which is responsible for collecting the tax. And today we're joined in this session by Elaine Lorimer, who's the Chief Executive of Revenue Scotland. And just for information of my colleagues, Elaine's also a member of the Budget Process Review Group, which had its first meeting last week. Obviously a very important organisation as far as this committee is concerned. And we're also joined by Chris Myerscough, the Head of Tax. I welcome our witnesses very warmly to the committee meeting proceedings this morning. And Elaine, I believe you might have a short opening statement you'd like to make.
Just a very short statement. Thank you very much, Convener, and thank you very much to you and your committee for inviting Chris and I to join you this morning. I'm conscious that the committee will have seen the written evidence we've submitted, and so I'll use this opportunity, if I may, just to highlight some key points from our evidence. And most of the things I want to talk about here is about the delivery of our organisation over its first year of operation. So in our first year, we've delivered a robust, secure online system for collection of tax with 98.1% of tax returns submitted online. We've established strong collaborative working relationships with the main professional bodies in Scotland, as well as the Scottish Government, the Scottish Fiscal Commission and HMRC. We've developed legislative guidance, including the use of case studies where possible and appropriate, involving the Law Society, the Chartered Institute of Taxation, and ICAS and others in their production. And this remains an ongoing dynamic process as we delve deeper into the application of our legislation to technically complex transactions. We've collected £425 million of lands and buildings transaction tax, which has gone into the Scottish Consolidated Fund to contribute to the funding of public services in Scotland. We've delivered the introduction of the additional dwelling supplement against a challenging timeframe and collected around £35 million of that supplement since April. And we've commenced our approach to compliance, using the powers granted by Parliament to protect the revenue. And we delivered all of this within a budget of less than 1% of the tax that we collected. Convener, it's a privilege to be the Chief Executive of Scotland's first tax authority since the Act of Union. And we at Revenue Scotland are very aware of the responsibility that Parliament has given us to deliver our statutory remit. And we want to deliver that in a way that is modern, efficient and robust, but with a strong sense of public service at its heart. And I hope the evidence that we give this morning will be helpful to the committee. And of course, we're ready to provide you with any further information should you require it of us following our discussion today.
Thank you very much, Elaine. Very grateful for that opening statement. Ash Denham, I think you've got a question you'd like to ask.
I do. Good morning. You might be aware that the committee's held a number of sessions on the operation of LBTT, and obviously Revenue Scotland has come up a number of times within that. And so I just wanted to start off by saying that, you know, many of our witnesses have expressed, you know, they're very happy with the operation of Revenue Scotland, and I think they probably would characterise it as being modern and efficient, as you say. However, one of the submissions that we had recently was actually from the Law Society, and this is probably quite a small area, but I was interested in your comments on it nonetheless. And they said that they felt that in some areas, the guidance in the more technical areas might be lacking. So I'll just read what they said in one area. They said that there were areas where there were equivalent guidance from HMRC, but none from Revenue Scotland, and other areas where Revenue Scotland had indicated it did not agree with HMRC, but had not issued the guidance. And I'd be interested in your comments on that.
Thank you. Yes, I'm aware of what the Law Society said in relation to that. I think the production of guidance is something which obviously we've been working very hard to achieve over our first year of operation. But it's fair to say that it would be impossible for us to provide definitive guidance on every particular aspect of our tax. Because essentially what we have to do is we have to work with the legislation that Parliament set us. And what we have to do is apply that legislation to the facts as they present themselves to us. And so some of the more technical transactions, as you can imagine, would be very difficult for us to produce definitive guidance about that because they're so fact-specific. I am conscious of the fact that the Society and, in fact, I think the Institute of Chartered Accountants as well in Scotland would like us to be more definitive in relation to where our legislation on the face of it looks pretty similar to the legislation in England and Wales, and where HMRC have taken a view in relation to their legislation, that's quite difficult for us to do so early on in our operation, because although on the face of it the legislation looks very similar, it's operating in entirely a different context in Scotland. And so our view is that we really need to have the opportunity to consider transactions which are very, the ones we're talking about here, be very technical, very fact specific. And it's only once we've had the experience of working through a number of those sorts of transactions that we might feel that we're in a place where we would be able to update our guidance. The other thing I'd like to say, though, if I may, is that because we work so closely and collaboratively with the professional bodies in Scotland, we are aware of a number of very sort of technical areas where they would like us, if possible, to come out with not quite guidance, but maybe a more technical view. And we've been working over the summer in order to try and produce something like that. And it's our intention within a very short period, I hope within the next month or so, that we would be able to publish what would be, we'd call like a technical update, which doesn't go so far as to go into our guidance, but provides a bit more guidance on some of the technical issues that the Law Society in particular have raised.
Neil Bibby?
Yeah, as Ash Denham said, the majority of the submissions that we've received seem to suggest that Revenue Scotland are performing well in terms of administering and collecting the tax. However, there are, you know, obviously a couple of concerns that have been raised, and one of those obviously is around the Law Society have talked about the negative feedback in relation to opinion service, and they've actually said it may be due to a lack of funding. The Scottish Property Federation have said that Revenue Scotland need to invest in awareness of its services and to prepare for the implementation of the rent reassessment process for non-residential rent. So I'd like to ask, do you feel you're adequately resourced at the moment to do the functions that you need to do, and going forward, do you need to have more resources?
That's a lovely question to ask a chief executive, because most of us would say, well, of course we'd love extra resources. But seriously, I think when you look at our opinion service, actually, which is, I think, possibly the root of some of your question there, we have a 25-day target that we set ourselves, working day target, to turn opinions round, and we have delivered the vast majority. I think there's only three out of all the opinion requests that we received that we didn't meet that deadline, and that was because they were so technical and we needed to get, you know, legal advice and council's opinion even perhaps on some of those. In relation to the resources, though, I think we have demonstrated with the way in which we've achieved our targets in our first year of operation, we have actually been adequately resourced. I mean, clearly there's always, with extra resource, there's more we could do in terms of further investment in our website, or, you know, we could do more outreach type work. But that's not to say we haven't been able to invest in our website or do outreach work. So sitting as I am at the moment, as far as I'm concerned, the resources that we have had in our first year of operation have more than demonstrated that we've had sufficient to be able to do what Parliament has asked us to do. I'm very conscious of the fact, though, looking forward, the expectations on our organisation are going to grow. We're going to be asked to deliver additional taxes. We know that your passenger tax, for example, is likely to come our way. And so part of what I need to do in the discussions which we will be undertaking with the government around the way in which we would wish to implement that tax, I will need to make sure that we are given sufficient additional resource to be able to invest in our systems, to be able to invest in a small number of additional staff, for example, to be able to take on any new tax.
In terms of when you're talking about a small additional number of staff, how many currently... How many people are employed in Revenue Scotland, and how many kind of roughly do you think you would need to take on those additional responsibilities?
We have around 50 staff at the moment in the organisation. We also fund additional staff in SEPA. One of the things which our organisation is held up for is the way in which we have taken a very efficient, very sort of lean approach to the way in which we have designed the organisation. And part of that has included looking at other organisations in Scotland who we can work in partnership with. And in fact, we have used our powers to delegate functions. We've delegated to SEPA, we've delegated to the Registers of Scotland for some aspects of our work, rather than building up a big machine centrally. So we have around 50 staff currently within our organisation, but we also fund, I think it's around a dozen staff in SEPA, for example, who work on our landfill tax with us.
Can you? Adam?
Thank you, Convener. I just wanted to pick up a little bit on the evidence that Ash Denham's already raised with you from the Law Society. And one of the phrases that the Law Society used in oral evidence to us that I found very striking as an academic lawyer was the idea that we are taxed by statute and untaxed by extra statutory concession. Yes. And I know that that's a model that HMRC have been using for a very long time indeed. Is it the right model for Scotland? Is it desirable? Is it inevitable? Are you content with it?
It's not the model we have in Scotland at all. Speaking just personally, I'm not entirely sure that that would be the model that we would want to follow. I mean, Chris knows more about this than I do, so I may bring her in here. But I think it's really important that the legislation is clear and that the legislation sets out publicly what the parameters of the remit of the tax is and or are, and what our role in relation to the collection and management of those would be. And so for us to come forward, we don't have the powers.
No. Do you think we've achieved that with LBTT? Do you think that the legislation on LBTT is sufficiently clear to meet that test?
I think the proof will be in the pudding. I think, obviously, we've had a successful first year in working with that legislation. I think where the legislation, as with any tax legislation, will be tested will be in the light of experience, in the light of really complex, the more complex technical questions that might come our way. And it's only when we have those to consider will we be able to see whether our legislation is clear enough for us or not. And that's where the tax tribunal, effectively, its role may come into play, because there will be some aspects, as there always is with the interpretation of legislation, where judgment calls are being made, where it needs to be put to the test, and the only place where you can get that definitive answer on the interpretation of the legislation is via the court, or via, in our case, the tax tribunal. But as it stands at the moment, we're able to work with the legislation as we find it.
Thank you. Did you want to add anything?
No, the comment that the Law Society made, yes, we picked up on that as well. And I think actually what they said was they didn't want that to be the case, that they didn't actually like the idea of being taxed, charged by the legislation and then effectively uncharged by the guidance. And I think, how we see our guidance, it's to explain to people how the legislation applies, not to define how the legislation applies. The legislation, if it's good legislation, which, as I say at the moment, we have no reason to believe it's not, should stand on its own in that respect.
Just panning out from that, if I may, and just thinking about institutional structures a little bit more broadly. Obviously, we're interested in LBTT partly for its own sake, but partly also looking forward with a view to more fiscal devolution in the first half of this Parliament. Do you think we've got the broad institutional structures right? And in particular, I'm thinking, I suppose, of the relationship between Revenue Scotland and Scottish ministers, and also the relationship between Revenue Scotland and HMRC. Are there any aspects of the institutional landscape that you think you'd like to draw to our attention with a view to us doing better than we currently do, or are you quite content?
I think, in the main, they work well. I mean, as I had the benefit of listening to Lady Rice's evidence earlier, and she talked about the need for discipline in the conduct of those relationships, because we all have our own sort of clearly defined remit. And I think it's fair to say we have those structures in place. So in relation to our relationship with the Scottish Government, we have a very clearly defined framework document which sets out, from our perspective, in working detail, if you like, how the relationship should work between us and Scottish Government, recognising our independence. In relation to HMRC, Clearly, we have mutual interest because tax and well, taxpayers don't just stop at the border, and so there are issues which we would want to be talking to HMRC about, and potentially in relation to particular taxpayers. And so we have information sharing agreements which are properly regulated. We have memoranda of understanding that sets out clearly what the relationship should be, and importantly from the taxpayer's perspective, how taxpayer information is protected within those boundaries. And we also have, because we've delegated our functions, some of our functions, to SEPA and to the Registers of Scotland, we also have to have those relationships properly defined as well, because clearly we are, as an organisation, asking them to undertake some of their functions for us. So. And I've missed out the Fiscal Commission. It's a complicated landscape, but we have, with all of those players in that landscape, we have clearly defined relationships in place, underpinned by some form of agreement or memorandum of understanding. So we have the structure there. Of course, what really matters is also the relationships to make, you can have all that underpinning as a framework in place, you actually need to have the relationships working too. And from my perspective, since I've arrived, I haven't seen anything that would cause concern in terms of everybody recognising where they're coming from, but also wanting to make the system work.
Thank you very much.
James Kelly.
Thanks a lot, convener. I'm just interested in the compliance activities that you noted in your submission, and it's obviously welcoming to note that you've collected £450,000 from those compliance activities. Just to kind of test that out, just say I decided to purchase a property for, say, £450,000, but I just completely ignored making an online return, decided I wasn't going to pay any tax on it. How would you catch me?
I'm not sure I want to answer that in open forum. Obviously, the first instance that we, as you've gathered, that we formally find out about a transaction is with the submission of the tax return. So I guess your question is, what happens if I don't make a tax return? And this is if, on the basis, and Chris will keep me right, but on the basis that you would wish to register your ownership of the property with Registers of Scotland, we would find out that you had registered your ownership of the property, and therefore we would be looking to undertake compliance.
I think the difficulty you would have is in registering a property, because the keeper requires confirmation from us that the tax return's been received and tax paid before she's able to accept application for registration. So if you're happy to do that and not have your title registered and take that risk, then so be it. But the chances are that if you did something like that regularly, sooner or later either Revenue Scotland or HMRC would catch up with you, because obviously we've got a considerable amount of other data and intelligence at our disposal, as have HMRC. So buyer beware, they say.
This number will get you. In terms of the previous evidence sessions we've had, we're aware that Revenue Scotland publishes outturn data for LVTT on its website, and that's obviously been very useful to us. But there's also been evidence led by witnesses that suggested that that would be helpful to have it, not just in terms of the tax bans, but also what happens within these tax bans and also regionally. Is that something that would be possible for Revenue Scotland to produce at this stage?
Everything is possible. I think what I would want to bring to the committee's attention, though, is that the production of some of this data isn't just about pressing some buttons on a system and our management information comes out. I think part of what we have learned over our first year of operation is that the level of information, the level of data, and the way in which that data can be manipulated is of increasing importance to organisations like the Fiscal Commission, to the Scottish Government. And the data that we publish, if you like, is our basic, factually correct, accurate data for our purposes, essentially, as a tax authority. What we're being asked to do is produce other types of data, which on the face of it wouldn't necessarily be critically important for us as a tax authority. So we've been working with the Scottish Government and the Fiscal Commission and the Office of Budget Responsibility. They also ask us for data to come to a consistent view as to what those additional calls on our data would be, so that we can look into how achievable that is. Some of it, yes, we have the information. It would require some additional time on the part of our statistician to pull it together in a way that, you know, he would feel was robust and he was comfortable with releasing it. Other aspects of some of the information we might be asked for might require a system change, and that's not so straightforward. So we are in a position where we are able to provide some extra levels of detail to the information that we provide at the moment. We're just working with the respective bodies to get a feel for, is there anything else they would want, so that we can then plan into our workload the release of that further information. I think the other thing I'd like to say too is that transparency is really important to us because of our independence. And so what we would be wanting to make sure is that where we are being asked to produce on a regular basis data, say by band or say by local authority, we were publishing that alongside the data that we currently publish, so that there is absolute visibility.
We are looking at it.
Yes, we are
looking. I just wanted to add that for us, obviously, it's essential that the data we publish is accurate and can be relied on, and so there would, you know, as well as the work to actually cut the data separately, there would be additional validation work required. So, for example, I heard Fiscal Commission saying they would like to know things by area. And certainly we do collect local authority area codes, but what we would need to ensure is that those then match up with the postcode of the property and that someone has selected the right area code. So it's around the making sure that not just that we can cut it, but that what we're giving them is accurate so they can rely on it.
Has anybody else got any other questions I'd like to ask? I've not been indicating from anybody else. Well, thank you, Elaine. Thank you, Chris. Sorry, Marie, apologies.
I was going to just ask a little bit about the additional dwelling supplement. You say it was introduced with a very challenging time frame, and we've heard from previous witnesses that there may have, you know, we may not have quite got the exemptions correct, or there's been suggestions that we should give better, you know, different exemptions or different time frames for repayments to be claimed. I wondered if you have any thoughts on whether it has posed difficulties with the collection and management of that tax, the additional dwelling supplement particularly, and whether there are refinements that we need to consider making.
I think it's difficult for me to get into matters of policy, because clearly that's not my role. What I would say is that in terms of lessons learned from introducing that tax, what we as an organisation were able to demonstrate was that we could introduce something like that without a whimper. You know, it just happened. And that involved system change, that involved huge work on our part collaboratively with the Law Society and others to produce our guidance. But it's not a time frame that I would like to be in a position of having to operate too often. Not so much to do with our organisation being ready. It's more to do with advisors being ready, externally, essentially Scotland being ready for a new tax. So I think in terms of lessons learned for us in relation to ADS, it is more to do with the amount of time that it should properly introduce a new tax into the system in Scotland that we need to have. And that's the sort of information that we are feeding into our colleagues in Scottish Government in terms of the planning for your passenger tax, for example. I'm mindful of some of the issues which came up during the debate on the legislation for ADS, and I'm conscious that, you know, commitments were made, for example, around looking at the grace period, etc. So we stand ready with our data to assist Scottish ministers in their assessment of whether the policy is working or not, mindful, you know, of the fact that they've got commitment to come back to the Parliament about it.
I guess that comes back to some of Adam Thompson's question around institutional issues as well, because if there's a tax change coming in Scotland, or if there's legislation coming through the Scottish Parliament. It's something that you'll be visible with. But if Westminster take a specific decision to change the tax at the drop of a hat, that seemed to happen in that circumstance, that gives organisations in Scotland less time to react. In the way that other, and while there might have been preparation time within the UK government, there might not be in that same preparation time here.
That's right. And that places huge stress on an organisation like ours, but we were able to deliver. I suppose at the cost of maybe spending more time developing our guidance. You know, we had to take a view on what our organisational priorities were for that last period. In terms of always being ready, though, I think it's part of the challenge of being the tax authority that change is always going to happen. It's a very dynamic taxation, it's a very dynamic environment. And so when I'm thinking about the resources that I need in my organisation and what we need to have, if you like, in terms of a small permanent resource, we need to have a small permanent resource, and we do have that in our organisation, which is skilled in quickly putting together a programme of change, which is essentially what this is, to redesign our systems, to produce our guidance, etc. So there is a recognition that because tax is so dynamic, the tax authority does need to, and if we're going to have to do things quickly, we need to have the capabilities and organisation to react and respond to that so that we can deliver.
Okay. Well, thank you very much for coming along and giving us some very clear evidence this morning. Very grateful to you. And again, thanks very much. At the start of the meeting, we agreed that we'd take item 3 in private, and we're going to move this session into private session. But before doing so, just a quick notice, the next meeting of the committee will take place on Wednesday, the 26th of October, when we'll take a final evidence station taken on LBTT from the Cabinet Secretary of Finance and Constitution. And I suspend this meeting at this stage and move into private. Thank you very much.